Good afternoon, students. I am Dr. Shweta Davadekar from Community Medicine Department. I am going to discuss about nutrition summary today. Nutrition is the topic which is taught to first MBBS students from 2019 admission batch for first MBBS. In second MBBS second term, this is routinely being taught, so second students also know about it. And for third first students, it was a tutorial topic for this term. So this way, my today's lecture will be of use to first MBBS second term students for whom 10 lectures on nutrition were taken. For second who have already completed this nutrition topic in second, and third first, for them tutorial was to be discussed. In the form of tutorial, this topic was to be discussed. So, nutrition is useful for all first, second, third MBBS. Now, this nutrition in two lectures. In first lecture, I will be covering about the basic principles of nutrition. Second lecture, giving the application of nutrition in day-to-day practice. The nutrition being implemented all over the country. So, specific instructional objectives of today's lecture are: number one is to know the approximate principles of diet, that is proteins, fats, carbohydrates, which are essential for human health, including their sources, daily requirements, mechanism of action, and deficiency disorders. Second objective is to know the micronutrients essential for human health, including individual vitamins and minerals which are included in the micronutrients, and their daily requirement, their sources, their mechanism of action, and deficiency disorders. Now we'll start with today's topic. Nutrition means the food that we consume. Food can be in the form of solids or it can be in the form of liquids, which is consumed by a person to serve a specific purpose, to fill his satiety or hunger, and to give him enjoyment. These are the specific functions of food. Now, the classification of different foods that we consume is given by different people at different times. As per the time of origin, they are classified as animal foods and plant foods. Animal foods are milk and milk products, eggs, meat, fish, etc. And plant foods are remaining all, that is cereals, pulses, vegetables and fruits. Second person had classified the nutrients into, as per the chemical composition, into proteins, fats, carbohydrates, vitamins and minerals. Third person classified them according to the predominant function that they carry out. Number one is bodybuilding foods like milk, meat, poultry, fish, eggs, pulses, nuts and oil seeds. While second group is energy giving food, in that cereals, sugar, roots and tubers, fats and oils. And third group is protective foods, in that the vegetables, oils and milk. The fourth person has classified the nutritive the foods into as per their nutritive value. They are cereals and pulses, cereals and millets. Now what are these millets? Daily we consume either wheat or rice or jawar, that is they come under the category of cereals. Now some people also consume this bajra, maize or ragi, or even the oats and barley, they come under the category of millets. Millets are small in size, they are having thick outer cover and the caloric content of them is very less. Second group in this as per the nutritive value is pulses, third is vegetables, fourth is nuts and oil seeds, fifth is fruits, fifth, next is animal foods, fats and oils, sugar and jaggery, condiments and spices. Now about this condiments and spices, the species, the peculiarity of this is they are consumed in a very small quantity, but they contain all the minerals and vitamins which are very very essential as micronutrients. As their requirement is in micro quantities, condiments and spices, they fulfill the requirement of a person, and there are certain miscellaneous food products also. Now about giving energy is the basic first and foremost function that is to be carried out by this nutrients. Person should get his energy needed from proteins, 10 to 15%, from fats 15 to 30%, and from carbohydrates 50 to 80%. He is also in need of micronutrients. These micronutrients will be in the form of vitamins and minerals. Now we start discussing with the proximate principles of diet. In that, first about the proteins. Proteins are chemically containing carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, and also they contain either iron or phosphorus or iodine and other chemicals. Basic functions carried out by proteins are bodybuilding. Number two is repair and maintenance. Number three is synthesis of antibodies, plasma proteins, hemoglobin formation, enzyme synthesis, hormone synthesis, and coagulation factors. And the remaining part of protein will also supply energy in the form of 4 calories per gram of protein. The different sources of proteins are animal sources in the form of milk, milk products, meat, eggs, cheese, fish and chicken. Among them, the best animal source of proteins is egg proteins, as the egg proteins are also called reference proteins because it contains all the essential amino acids that are needed by a person in the same proportion that a human being needs. They are present in the egg protein, and so egg protein is called a reference protein. Now, second best quality of animal source of protein is fish. Fish is rich in iodine also, and the proteins present in the fish are easily digested and they are of unique quality. About mutton and chicken also, they are rich in proteins. Now about the plant sources of proteins, in that cereals, beans, nuts and oil seeds. The best plant source of protein, if somebody asks, is soya bean, and second one is groundnuts, and others also contain some amount of proteins. Cereals contain about 11 grams of proteins, and these pulses contain about 20 grams of proteins. Limiting amino acid is one of the concepts that all of you should know. Every nutrient is having essential amino acids, but all of them, they are not present in every nutrient. If it is deficient in that protein, then that is called limiting amino acid of that substance. Now to combat this problem of limiting amino acids, supplementary action of proteins is routinely being carried out. It is carried out by mutual benefit when two food items are consumed simultaneously. Best example of it can be given as that of rice and dal. Rice is deficient in lysine and dal is deficient in methionine. So the combination of these two gives both the essential amino acids to a person. Evaluation of protein is decided, or it is calculated, by this formula of biological value, digestibility coefficient, net protein utilization, and protein efficiency ratio. Now what are these? The quality of proteins is decided by first actually it should be digestibility coefficient. Digestibility coefficient is the nitrogen intake and out of it how much is the nitrogen absorbed. Proteins are having a specific chemical in them, and that is nitrogen. Out of the nitrogen that is taken in the food, how much it is absorbed by the body is called digestibility coefficient. Now, biological value of protein is out of the absorbed nitrogen, how much is retained in the body, that is biological value. Net protein utilization is out of nitrogen intake, how much nitrogen is retained in the body is net protein utilization. And fourth one is protein efficiency ratio, that is out of the total protein that is consumed by a person in grams, how much weight gain he had in grams, that is protein efficiency ratio. These are the four different formulas, the four different indicators to decide the quality of proteins. Now about essential amino acids. Total there are 20 essential amino acids. All of them are needed by the body, but out of them 9 are called essential amino acids because they are needed by the body but cannot be synthesized in the body. So from our diet we have to supply these amino acids. So they are called these 9 essential amino acids are remembered as IL-PMTVTH, that is isoleucine, lysine, leucine, phenylalanine, methionine, threonine, valine, tryptophan and histidine. The functions carried out by these amino acids, some of the functions I have enumerated. Number one is niacin is one of the vitamin B complex. It is formed from tryptophan, one of the essential amino acid. So tryptophan is a precursor of niacin. Second important function is cysteine and tyrosine are essential amino acids for premature babies. Animal proteins are superior to plant proteins as they are biologically complete proteins. That is, they contain all the essential amino acids that are needed by human beings. Egg protein is the best example of it. About protein requirement, ICMR has suggested that the protein requirement of a person should be 1 gram per kg body weight for Indian adult when the net protein utilization that he is consuming is of 65 level. Protein requirement varies as per the age, number one. In pediatric age, the rate of growth and development is very fast, so protein requirement is more. In adolescents, again the same, the growth and development is taking place very fast. As reproductive organs and secondary sexual characters are being developed in adolescents, so protein requirement is more. Then next is physiological conditions like pregnancy and lactation. The requirements are more because during pregnancy, the fetus is growing in the utero of mother, so she has to supply more amount of proteins to her baby. And during lactation, the milk that is being secreted require for that milk formation, the proteins are required, and that is why the needs of protein are more during these two physiological conditions. During infections, as immunological response for any infection is either in the form of antibody formation or cell mediated immunity or bactericidal activity or leukocyte count has increased. But actually in infections it is decreased. So we have to improve the leukocyte count, and for all this excess of proteins are needed, and so during infections the protein supplementation should be more. About the supplementary action of proteins, already it has been said that amino acids of two food items in combination mutually help in taking care of the deficiency, example of that is dal and rice or thali pit bhajani in Maharashtra. Those who are from Maharashtra state, they might be knowing this, what is this thali pit bhajani. Now protein deficiency leads to a condition called as kwashiorkor. Kwashiorkor or moon face, edema all over the body showing protein deficiency disorders is common in protein deficient areas, especially in pediatric age group. Malnutrition is basically caloric deficiency in which supplement should be energy rich, easily available, commonly accepted food, freely to be made available to improve the nutritional status. Especially attention is given to protein supplementation so as to carry out the function of antibody formation, cell mediated immunity, hormone synthesis, enzyme synthesis, plasma protein formation, globin of hemoglobin synthesis. All these functions will be carried out by these proteins if supplementation is given in sufficient quantity. Now today's concept is the malnutrition in pediatric age group is classified as SAM, that is severe acute malnutrition, or MAM, that is medium acute malnutrition. Criteria for SAM that has been accepted all over the world is weight for age if less than median minus 3 SD, then he is called a SAM child. Now here remember the word that I am using is median. So here not average or mean, average age is taken, but here median is taken because there might be some children who are of extreme age and their age may get affected, may affect while calculating the average weight, and that is why nowadays instead of taking average weight, median is considered. And so median minus 3 SD, if the weight of a child is less than median minus 3 SD, then that child is called SAM child. And if the weight is median minus 2 SD, between 2 SD and 3 SD, then he is called MAM child, that is medium acute malnutrition child. Second way of classifying is MUAC, that is medium, mid upper arm circumference is taken. What is this mid upper arm circumference? Now the left arm of a child, in the left arm of a child, the acromion process of scapula, that is at the shoulder, and olecranon process of ulna, these are the two bony prominences you might be remembering which were taught in anatomy. These mark these two bony prominences, measure the distance between these two bony prominences, divide it by two, that gives you the midpoint of this arm. And at that midpoint, with the help of Shakir's stick, you can measure the mid upper arm circumference. This mid upper arm circumference, if less than 11.5 centimeters, then that child is called SAM child, that is severe acute malnutrition child, and for him specific nutrients are needed. Now the second important food item is fats. Fats are solids at room temperature. They are liquids at high temperature. They are classified as simple lipids, that is triglycerides, compound lipids like phospholipids, and derived lipids like cholesterol. There are two types of fats: saturated fatty acids and unsaturated fatty acids. Saturated fatty acids are all animal sources of fats, and also some plant sources like palm oil and coconut oil, they are also saturated fatty acids. Unsaturated fatty acids are all plant sources of fatty acids they come under the category of MUFA or PUFA. MUFA is monounsaturated fatty acids and polyunsaturated fatty acids. Now, fats are classified as visible fats and invisible fats. Ghee and cooking oil, they come under the category of visible fats, while oils which are not visible to the naked eye but which are present in the food item are called invisible fats. I can give you the example. Wheat, rice, bajra, these are the, I have given you some examples in which invisible fat is in a considerable quantity is present in them. So while calculating the amount of fat consumed by a person, you have to take into consideration the invisible fat that you have consumed. Now, regarding the important functions carried out by fats, number one is to supply fat-soluble vitamins like vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin E and vitamin K. To supply essential fatty acids like linoleic acid, linolenic acid and arachidonic acid. Third important function carried out by fats is they supply sufficient energy. That energy is in the form of 9 calories per gram. Very, very rich in calories. Now, the next dangerous fatty acid is also there, that is called trans fatty acids. Trans fatty acids take long time to get removed from the body. They are produced when fats are reheated again and again. The high risk conditions due to excess of fat consumption are, number one is obesity, number two is hypertension, and number three is diabetes mellitus, and fourth is certain cardiovascular conditions. Now, these fats that a person consumes are classified as simple lipids, that is triglycerides, compound lipids as phospholipids, and derived lipids as cholesterol. And dangerous lipids is trans fatty acids. Monounsaturated fatty acids are the ones which contain only one double bond. They are liquid at room temperature. Examples of monounsaturated fatty acids are olive oil, rapeseed oil, oleic acid, meat fat and lard. It does not raise the cholesterol level. That is the advantage. It lowers the LDL, that is low density lipoproteins levels, without affecting the high density lipoproteins levels. That is the advantage of MUFA. About PUFA, that is polyunsaturated fatty acids, are double bonds. They are liquid at room temperature. They are involved in cholesterol metabolism. The components of phospholipids in cell membrane and precursors of prostaglandins, interleukins and thromboxins. Vital role is in immune response, blood clotting and inflammation. Polyunsaturated fatty acids derived from essential fatty acids, that is linoleic acid is N6, alpha linolenic acid is N3, and so they also omega-3 and omega-6. Omega-3 is present in fish and fish oils, soya bean, rapeseed oil and leafy vegetables. Now, benefits are, it decreases the risk of cardiovascular diseases and benefits cognitive function of brain. Regarding trans fatty acids, formation of trans, that is TFAS, which increases the risk of cardiovascular diseases and increases LDL level, that is low density lipoprotein level, and decreases HDL, which are actually the protective high density lipoproteins levels. Now, fat requirement of a person is around 20% of the total energy requirement. On an average, a moderate activity person like a student, he requires around 2000 calories. Out of these 2000 calories, 20%, that means around 400 calories you should get from fats. For Indian adult, per day requirement is around 20 to 40 grams per day. and in that again he will have to divide it into visible fat and invisible fat and decide as to how much fat he should consume daily. Deficiency of fats leads to vitamin A deficiency, D deficiency, E deficiency and K deficiency. Now WHO has recommended how much should be the intake of fat. For that, this is the next slide. Saturated fat should be less than 7% if energy intake in high risk person. High risk means already obese, hypertensive, diabetic or cardiovascular disease. That person should take only less than 7% of saturated fats. The normal person can take saturated fat up to less than 10% of energy intake. Among them, polyunsaturated fatty acids should be 6 to 10%, N6 should be 5 to 8%, N3 should be 1 to 2%. About MUFA, that is monounsaturated fatty acids, will be by difference total fat intake 1% E minus SFA minus PUFA minus TFA. That is how the MUFA requirement should be calculated. Regarding trans fatty acids, it should be less than 1%, and cholesterol should be less than 300 milligrams per day. Now regarding carbohydrates, the third approximate principle, around 50 to 80% of the energy needed by a person should come from carbohydrates in the form of starch, sugar, cellulose and fibers. Now the staple diet that a person consumes is wheat, rice, jawar, bajra or maize. From that maximum, that is 50 to 80% of the calories he gets. Now the calories that he consumes, some of them are stored in the body in the form of glycogen. Glycogen is insoluble in water and it is stored in the body up to 500 grams in adult body they are present. Now from when it is converted into glycogen, if a person has taken extra calories than his daily need, then these extra calories will be converted into glycogen and it will be stored as glycogen in his body. Next concept about carbohydrates you should know is about glycemic index. Glycemic index of a food is the area under 2 hours blood sugar response curve following ingestion of 50 grams of food product under as a precursor of the standard glucose or white bread. Now what does it mean? A person gives that particular item to be consumed for eating equivalent to 50 grams of white bread or standard glucose. When you have given the food to eat, that time take his blood and find out the blood sugar level. Every half an hour take his blood sample and find out the blood sugar level. That way go on doing it up to 2 hours. Don't give any other food to eat and plot a graph. That graph covers some area and that area is called glycemic index. Now the glycemic index can be low glycemic index, medium glycemic index or high glycemic index. And accordingly the foods are classified as low glycemic index are the ones which are having less than 55 value of glycemic index. In that the fruits and vegetables are the ones, slow digested foods. Medium glycemic index is basmati rice and brown rice, where glycemic index is between 56 to 69. And high glycemic index are the ones which contains cornflakes, baked potato and white bread, where glycemic index is 70 or more. They are rapidly digested or absorbed carbohydrates. Now you will ask me, what is its importance? Why should we know about glycemic index? So its application is in planning a diet of a diabetic person. If I am asked to plan a diet for a diabetic person, then I should choose medium and low glycemic index foods, and also I should tell how much quantity that he or she should consume, so that exactly how many calories he will get and he will not have the problem of overnutrition. That way the knowledge of glycemic index will be of help. Now the next source of carbohydrates is fibers. Dietary fibers are of two types, soluble fibers and insoluble fibers. They give roughage to the diet, that is the advantage. Secondly, they give bulk to the diet, so that the total quantity consumed by a person is comparatively less, because it gives satiety, that is sensation of fullness of stomach, but the amount of calories that he has consumed is comparatively less. So very less amount of energy but satiety, that is the advantage of fibers. On consumption, it reduces the incidence of coronary heart disease. That is one more important advantage of this fibers. The requirement of fibers is 40 grams per day for a person who is consuming 2000 calories per day. Also, the fibers, they give roughage, so the problem of constipation is taken care of by these fibers. Now, about different sources of carbohydrates that we have already seen, that wheat, rice, jawar, bajra, maize, ragi, which are the staple diets, and also pulses, legumes, potato and sweet potato are the sources of carbohydrates. And about the sources of fibers, they are soluble fibers are citrus fruits like orange, figs, grapes, guava, pomegranate. And insoluble ones are the fibers from vegetables, beans, ragi and pulses. Deficiency of carbohydrates leads to a condition called marasmus. Marasmus is monkey face, that is skin and bones. There is no muscle development because of the deficiency of diet. And nowadays these deficient children of kosher corn in protein deficiency, I said, and here in carbohydrate deficiency, marasmus, both of them, they are classified as SAM and MAM children. This way here I have finished the proteins, fats and carbohydrates. Now about the micronutrients that a person has to consume every day in the form of vitamins and minerals. Required in micro quantities, so they are called micronutrients, but they serve a very, very important basic functions. Now we will see one by one. First we will see about vitamins. Vitamins are vital amines. They are classified as water soluble vitamins, that is vitamin B complex and vitamin C, and fat soluble vitamins are vitamin A, vitamin D, vitamin E and vitamin K. Vitamin A, C and E, they act as antioxidants. Means what? Very commonly asked question, what is antioxidant? Antioxidant is the one which traps the singlet oxygen that is generated during the chemical reaction or lipid peroxidation is called antioxidants. Now, out of these four fat-soluble vitamins, vitamin A, C and E, three of them, they are antioxidants. C is not fat-soluble, it is water-soluble. Vitamin A is in two forms. Preformed vitamin, that is retinol, present in meat, milk, fish and eggs. These are the animal sources of this vitamin A. And provitamins, that is carotenoids, are present in colored fruits and colored vegetables. Yellow colored fruits, orange colored fruits and vegetables like pumpkin, papaya, mango and peaches. They are rich in vitamin A. The important functions carried out by this are normal vision, retinal pigment formation for dim light vision, maintaining the integrity and normal functioning of glandular and epithelial tissue, supports the skeletal growth and anti-infective properties, protects against some epithelial cancers. Sources of vitamin A are egg, butter, cheese, fish and milk, from animals and from plants, green leafy vegetables, colored vegetables and fruits. Carotenes are converted into vitamin A, and also fortified foods are the sources of vitamin A. Deficiency leads to xerophthalmia, that is, the symptoms are night blindness, conjunctival xerosis, vitreous spots, corneal xerosis and keratomalacia. Morbidity may lead to morbidity due to vitamin A deficiency may be respiratory or gastrointestinal infections. Prevention of vitamin A deficiency can be carried out by concentrated solution of vitamin A in the dose of 1 lakh international units at 9 months of age. Generally, it is given along with measles vaccine, and 2 lakh international units from 1.5 to 5 years of age, total 9 times, 6 monthly, prophylactic dose of 2 lakh international units to every child is given to get stored in the liver and utilized by the body as and when needed by the body. Next vitamin that we are going to discuss is vitamin E. Vitamin E, also known as tocopherol, is rich in vegetable oils, cottonseed oil, sunflower seeds, egg yolk, butter, foods rich in PUFA, that is polyunsaturated fatty acids. Now remember this next very very important point, that mega dose of vitamin A may give cytotoxic effects. So as in case of vitamin A, we are giving mega dose of vitamin A multiple times and making it stored in the body. But similarly, though vitamin E is also fat soluble, it cannot be given in mega doses. Regarding vitamin D, vitamin D is of two forms, calciferol, that is vitamin D2, and cholecalciferol is vitamin D3. Vitamin D3 is naturally occurring in animal fats and fish liver oil. Ultraviolet rays in presence of sunlight convert cholesterol in the skin to vitamin D, and it is stored in fat depots. Vitamin D also acts as kidney hormone in metabolically active and undergoes transformation. Active metabolites are 25 HCC to 1.25 DHCC. First it is stored in liver, then in kidney, then bound to transport proteins and carried to bones and intestines. Vitamin D is not a dietary requirement, as in presence of sunlight it can be synthesized in the body if in adequate quantities. If for 5 minutes exposure to sunlight below the skin, it can be formed in presence of fat that is present below the skin. Only limitation of this type of vitamin D formation is air pollution may come in the way, or dark skin will filter the ultraviolet rays, and so no vitamin D formation in natural way in such people. Dietary sources of vitamin D are liver, egg yolk, butter, cheese and human milk. Deficiency of vitamin D leads to rickets, that is growth failure, bone deformity, muscular hypotonia, tetany, convulsions due to hypokalemia. On investigations, increased serum alkaline phosphatase level, curled legs, deformed pelvis, pigeon chest, Harrison sulcus, rickety rosary, and kyphoscoliosis. These will be the manifestations of vitamin D deficiency syndrome. Walking and teething. These milestones are delayed in pediatric age group. Osteomalacia in adult women during adults. In case of women during pregnancy and lactation, vitamin D deficiency may develop and this condition may get worsened. So prevention of vitamin D deficiency is expose the children to sunlight and give fortified milk. Daily requirement is around 400 international units or 10 milligrams. Vitamin K. Vitamin K is in two forms, K1 and K2. K1 sources, K1 is rich in green leafy vegetables and cow milk. K2 is synthesized in the intestine by bacteria. Vitamin K is stored in liver. Functions are, it helps in coagulation of blood. Deficient in newborns, so they are given injection Minadiol in the dose of 0.1 to 0.2 milligrams, especially the high-risk groups. Or 0.5 milligram of vitamin K as a prophylactic dose is given. Now regarding the water-soluble vitamins, the next group, thiamine or vitamin B1 is useful for utilization of carbohydrates. Deficiency of thiamine will lead to accumulation of pyruvic acid and lactic acid in the tissues and body fluids. Sources of thiamine are cereals and milk. Loss occurs during the routine processes of milling of rice from paddy, washing of rice. Too much of washing will throw away the thiamine. The cooking of rice. While cooking, extra water is added and removed at the end. Then all thiamine is thrown out. Then toasting. When a toast is prepared, while toasting, some amount of thiamine is lost. Then use of baking soda. If baking soda is used for preparation of any food item, the thiamine content of the food is wasted. Then removing excess water from the rice while cooking will remove or throw away the thiamine. This way, these are the processes that they remove thiamine from diet, and so such people are prone for the condition called beriberi. Now deficiency of vitamin B1 causes beriberi, which is of three types: dry beriberi, wet beriberi, and infantile beriberi. Dry beriberi is the condition in which there is peripheral neuritis. In wet beriberi, it is the cardiac manifestation, so cardiac beriberi. And third one is infantile beriberi, where the signs of peripheral neuropathy and Wernicke's encephalopathy. In alcoholics, those who are consuming lot of alcohol, in them, thiamine deficiency definitely develops, and the manifestations are ophthalmoplegia, polyneuritis, ataxia, and mental deterioration. So prevention of beriberi in these people is stop alcohol consumption, use parboiled rice, because parboiling process preserves thiamine content of the rice. And third thing is give daily thiamine in the dose of 30 milligrams per day is recommended. Also those who are on hemodialysis, in them thiamine deficiency is common. Those who are having a problem of persistent vomiting, or those whose prolonged gastric aspiration is being done, or those who go on fast for a long time, for such people thiamine deficiency is very common. So for them 30 milligrams of thiamine per day is recommended. Second vitamin is vitamin riboflavin or vitamin B2. Fundamental role in cell oxidation. It maintains integrity of mucocutaneous structure. It is a cofactor in a number of enzymes involved in cell in energy metabolism. It is important antioxidant activity, cofactor for glutathione reductase like enzyme needed for vitamin B6, niacin and vitamin K metabolism. Sources of riboflavin are milk, eggs, liver, kidney, green leafy vegetables, meat and fish. Germination process or sprouting increases the riboflavin content of pulses and cereals. So vegetarians should have the habit of eating germinated cereals and pulses. Deficiency leads to angular stomatitis in malnourished children and chiliosis, glossitis and nasolabial dysphagia. Riboflavin impair neuromuscular function, increase susceptibility to cataract. Requirements are, it being a water soluble vitamin, it is not stored in the body. So requirements are 0.6 milligrams per 1000 calories, that is 1.2 milligrams for a person consuming 2000 calories per day. Niacin is vitamin B3, which is essential for carbohydrate, fat, protein metabolism, normal functioning of skin, intestine and nervous system. Essential amino acid tryptophan is the precursor of niacin. It is not excreted in urine. In maize it is present, but it is in the bound form, so it is not made available to the consumer. Niacin deficiency leads to a condition called as pellagra, and pellagra is described by 3 D's: diarrhea, dementia and dermatitis. Dermatitis is on exposed part of the sunlight, there, that is back of hands and lower legs, face and neck. These are the places where dermatitis occurs in niacin deficient person. Depression, irritability and delirium, these are the conditions developed because of niacin deficiency. In sorghum eaters, that is jowar eaters and maize eaters, due to excess of leucine, it interferes in the conversion of tryptophan into niacin, and so pellagra is the common condition. Prevention of niacin deficiency is by giving milk and meat in the diet, avoid sorghum or maize in the diet, and the disease can be eliminated. Daily requirements are 6 milligrams per 1000 calories, that is 12 milligrams per 2000 calories per day. Next is vitamin B6 or pyridoxin. Pyridoxin, pyridoxal and pyridoxamine, these are the 3 chemical contents. It plays an important role in the metabolism of amino acids, fats and carbohydrates. Sources of pyridoxin are milk, liver, meat, egg yolk, fish, cereals, legumes and vegetables. Deficiency of pyridoxin leads to peripheral neuritis detected in INH, that is those who are consuming as an anti-tubercular drug, those who are consuming this INH in them, the deficiency of vitamin B6 is very common. Daily requirements are 2 milligrams per day, and during pregnancy and lactation the requirements are more, that is 2.5 milligrams per day. Pantothenic acid or vitamin B8 is carries important role in adrenal cortical function and biosynthesis of corticosteroids. Daily requirements are 10 milligrams if all the food supply is in adequate quantities in the diet, and 3 milligrams of it is excreted in urine. Next important is folic acid. Folic acid is available in nature in 2 forms, free folates and bound folates. Free folates are rapidly absorbed from proximal part of the small intestine. Folic acid is available, availability of bound folates is uncertain. Functions are synthesis of nucleic acid, that is it is a constituent of chromosomes, normal cell development in bone marrow. Sources are liver, meat, dairy products, then eggs, milk, fruits, cereals and leafy vegetables. Deficiency may occur who have poor diet, especially in pregnancy and lactation, leading to megaloblastic anemia, glossitis, chiliosis, gastrointestinal disturbances and infertility. Requirements are more during growth, lactation and in growing children. That is why for every pregnant woman we are giving FSFA tablets, that is ferrous sulfate folic acid tablets. As per the ICMR, the requirements are for healthy adults 200 micrograms, during pregnancy it is 500 micrograms, during lactation it is 300 micrograms and in children it is 80 to 120 micrograms. Vitamin B12, next is vitamin B12, that is cyanocobalamin, which is cheap, used for DNA synthesis. Deficiency leads to megaloblastic anemia. For its physiological absorption, intrinsic factor from stomach is needed, absorbed only at a special site in the terminal ileum. Sources are liver, kidney, meat, fish, eggs, milk and cheese. There is no vegetarian source of vitamin B12, so in vegetarians, vitamin B12 deficiency is very, very common. Total 4 milligrams are stored in the body, so deficiency is rarely observed, it is said, but actually vitamin B12 deficiency is nowadays being detected. Deficiency leading to megaloblastic anemia, that is pernicious anemia, demyelinating neurological lesions in spinal cord and infertility. Daily requirements of vitamin B12 are normal 1 microgram, normal adult, pregnancy 1.2 micrograms, lactation 1.5 micrograms, in infants and children 0.2 micrograms. Now next vitamin is vitamin C, which is also water soluble. It is also called ascorbic acid. Chemically it is water soluble, most sensitive to heat, and only man, monkey and guinea pigs, they are in need of vitamin C. Ascorbic acid important function is it is an antioxidant. It is important for the formation of collagen. Deficiency of vitamin C will lead to hemorrhages and bone fractures easily. It converts ferric iron to ferrous iron and so facilitates absorption from vegetable foods. Prevention from common cold and protection from infection. Now the next group that we are going to discuss amongst these micronutrients is minerals. There are around 50 minerals, 50 chemical elements are found in human body for growth, regular functions, repairs and maintenance. Among them, iron, iodine, fluorine, zinc, copper, cobalt, chromium, manganese, molybdenum, selenium, nickel, tin, silicon and vanadium are of use. There are certain trace elements which are not having some specific functions. They can be called as contaminants. They are lead, mercury, barium, boron and aluminium. Now the concept of bioavailability is very important in case of minerals. What is it meant by? Bioavailability means though it is present in the food, it cannot be consumed by the body or it cannot be absorbed by the body because of the other substances that are coming in the way. For example, in case of iron and zinc may be less due to phytic acid like substances which may interfere the absorption. So this is about bioavailability of a substance is important in minerals. About calcium. Calcium is a major element constitutes about 1.5 to 2% of the body weight, of which 98% is present in bones and in blood around 10 milligrams per dl. The equilibrium is maintained by vitamin D, parathyroid hormone and calcitonin. The important functions carried out by calcium are bone formation, teeth formation, blood coagulation, muscle contraction, cardiac action, milk production, transformation of light on electrical impulses in the retina. to keep the cell membrane intact, then cell division are the important functions carried out by calcium. Now, sources of calcium are milk and milk products. Second is green leafy vegetables, then the ragi or nachni, then drinking water, and fruits like sitafal are rich in calcium. Calcium is absorbed only 20 to 30% because of the presence of phytates, oxalates and fatty acids in the diet. So bioavailability of calcium is only 20 to 30%. Absorption is enhanced by vitamin D. Absorption is regulated as per the body needs. Deficiency is not commonly detected. Requirements are, daily requirements are around 600 milligrams for adults. Phosphorus. Phosphorus is needed for bones and teeth formation. Intake should be equal to that of calcium. Next among the minerals is sodium. Human body contains about 100 grams of sodium ions. Loss in urine is definitely regulated by the kidney, but loss through sweat is not regulated at all. Depletion causes muscular cramps. Requirements of sodium are 5 grams per day. Excess consumption may lead to hypertension. Potassium. Potassium is the next in the minerals. Adult body contains around 250 grams of potassium. It is vasoactive, increases blood flow, sustains metabolic need of the tissue. Sodium potassium should be of equal quantity, 1:1 in millimoles. Next is magnesium. Magnesium is present in bones and all the body cells, needed for calcium and potassium metabolism. Deficiency is common in chronic alcoholics, liver cirrhosis patients, and also in toxemia of pregnancy. In PEM, that is protein energy malnutrition and malabsorption syndrome, in that also magnesium deficiency is manifested in the form of irritability, tetany, hyperreflexia, or occasionally hyporeflexia. Now next mineral is iron. Human body contains around 3 to 4 grams of ions. 60 to 70% of it is present in hemoglobin and remaining is present in the stores. Functions are hemoglobin formation, brain development, regulation of body temperature, muscle activity, myoglobin formation, oxygen transportation and cell respiration. Important sources of iron are heme iron in the form of liver, meat, poultry, fish and other animal sources, and non-heme iron sources are green leafy vegetables, cereals, legumes, nuts, oil seeds, jaggery, green dry fruits. Again, bioavailability is the problem. Bioavailability is less due to phytates, oxalates, carbonates, phosphates and dietary fibers which interfere iron absorption. Also, milk, eggs and tea inhibit iron absorption. Absorption is in duodenum or in the small intestine. Rate of absorption is influenced by body reserves and also the body's requirement. In pregnancy, the rate of absorption is more, so it increases. The absorbed iron is stored in liver, spleen, bone marrow and kidney and utilized by the body as per the need. Losses are during, number one is physiological condition, that is in case of women during menstruation, around 12.5 milligrams of iron is loss. Then pathological conditions like malaria, hookworm infestation, hemorrhoids and IUD insertion. These are the conditions in which there is iron loss. Deficiency can be explained in three stages. In first stage, the stores are decreased, but no detectable abnormality is seen. In second stage, that is the intermediate stage, where the stores are exhausted, but no anemia is detected. Transferrin levels are 15 to 30%, and this condition is widely prevalent in India. Remember, intermediate stage of iron deficiency is over in India. Third is overt iron deficiency, that is decreased concentration of hemoglobin percentage due to impaired synthesis of hemoglobin. Effect of iron deficiency leads to anemia, impaired cell mediated immunity, increased morbidity and mortality, diminished work performance. Diagnosis leads to normal level of hemoglobin. In diagnosis of iron deficiency anemia is in adult male it is 13 grams per dl, in adult female it is 12 grams per dl, in pregnancy it is 11 grams per dl, in children it is 11 grams per dl, between 6 months to 6 years it is 11, and between 6 months to 14 years it is 12. Iron requirement, daily requirement should be, in males it should be 0.84, in females it should be 1.65, pregnancy 2.8 milligrams, lactation 1.65 milligrams, infants 46 to 87 micrograms, children between 9 years, up to 9 years, 45 to 0.77 milligrams, in adolescent boys it is 1.05 to 1.6 milligrams, in adolescent girls it is 1.3 to 1.36 milligrams. So iron requirement is more in all females, that is what you must have observed. Now regarding iodine deficiency, iodine is essential micronutrient needed for thyroid hormone. Human body contains about 50 milligrams, out of that blood contains about 8 to 12 micrograms per dl. Sources are sea fish, sea salt, cod liver oil. Small quantities are present in milk, meat, vegetables, cereals, drinking water and soil. Deficiency in the soil will be deficiency in water, it will be deficiency in food grown in that area, and so geochemical deficiency. Goitrogens, cauliflower, cabbage, cyanocobalamin, thiocyanates interfere with the process of absorption of iodine from food which contains iodine in micro quantities. Iodine deficiency leads to spontaneous abortions, cretinism, deaf mutism, myxedema, dwarfism. Requirements are 150 micrograms. During pregnancy, 250 micrograms. Deficiency leads to hypothyroidism. Physical development, retardation, impaired mental function, neurological cretinism, deaf mutism and myxedema. Prevalence of goiter, epidemiological assessment of IDD is by prevalence of goiter, prevalence of cretinism, urinary iodine excretion, prevalence of neonatal hypothyroidism, serum vitamin D3, serum T3, T4, TSH levels. Most sensitive indicators of thyroid insufficiency are among the neonatal hypothyroidism and serum T4 levels. थांबू का सर इथे नाही अजून दोन तीन स्लाइड्स राहिल्या काय करू बरं ठीक आहे मी थांबू फ्रेंड्स वी विल कंटिन्यू स्टुडंट्स वी विल कंटिन्यू दिस लेक्चर इन इन द नेक्स्ट वीक सो थँक यू समरी ऑफ न्यूट्रिशन पार्ट वन इज not over, 3-4 slides I'll be covering in part 2, and part 2 will be in the next week. Thank you for patient listening.